I was very much surprised. One time I went into a meeting, it was Leukemia 2008, and I talked to pharmaceutical companies that were there, and they were putting so many new products, and what I noticed is that none of the new products had a known mechanism. They just know what the effect is. In other words, this product kills cells at this rate. I mean, we're talking about cancer, so it's always going to be killing cells. And so this product kills them at this rate, this product kills them at this rate. And I'm trying to figure out how. No one knows. Most of the time, no one knows. And so I was actually, I remember being so surprised and talking to the reps, and I felt almost like they kind of got a little bit embarrassed because they wanted to kind of shake me off. But I was honestly surprised. I was like, how come we don't know? I mean, do you know how? How many of you use acetaminophen? Tylenol, right? I mean, it's like Tylenol, everybody, right? Do you know no one knows how Tylenol works? No one knows how Tylenol works. No one knows this mechanism. They would just know it works. We assume, and I think there's a belief that it inhibits the COX-3 enzyme, which is kind of elusive. But that's what we know. Many drugs are like that. We just know what they do. We don't know how they do it. We don't know what to do. So, but ideally, if we want to, you know, generate a drug specifically for this enzyme, we would know how the enzyme works so that we don't target it. You just get this library of billions of molecules and you start testing them. Whichever inhibits that is not a molecule. That's really what happens. Honestly. First, it's done in the computer. You keep docking and docking site, different models, whatever fits best. You take like maybe 50 of those out of millions, really, and then you make them and you start doing cell studies. And whichever inhibits that enzyme, oh, actually, in vitro, whichever inhibits that enzyme best, and you select those five by chance, move into cell studies. Whichever gives the best cell data, move into animal studies. And whenever it passes in animal studies, if anyone did anything pass animal studies, then it goes to clinical studies. Nobody really studies. Whatever works, you know, that's what really matters. And whatever gives the least side effects, that's what really matters. But sometimes we can do it properly, you know, like know the mechanism. So it is important for us to understand. And one of the ways that we can understand is using the line of word plots. And based on the shape they take after multiple studies, we can derive the mechanism of that enzyme, or whether there is or there isn't a ternary complex. And the ternary complex, if we do a lot of work studies and plots under the same amount of enzyme and S, given S2 concentration, and the S1 changes over time, we get these plots. And if they cross in this quadrant, in this fashion, that will tell you that there is a ternary complex. If you get perpendicular lines like this, that will tell you that there is no ternary complex formed between the two substrates and the enzyme. Once you get into metabolism next semester, for those of you that will, you will realize that there is a rarely an enzyme that doesn't have two substrates. Rarely. I shouldn't say that. Let me rephrase that. There are many enzymes that have two or more substrates. I mean, a great variety. Almost every pathway that you can imagine.
Could you repeat again how you could tell? There was a point in there where it was just, I got lost. Could you explain it again?
Sure. I know exactly what part got you lost. By the way, I know exactly. You're talking about the S1 being constant. I'm just trying to, you know, when you look sometimes at these graphs, you look at the graph and say, okay, if the graphs cross, that's a ternary complex. But that means nothing. You know, how was this derived? I was trying to say that in a sentence, but I knew that. Anyway. So, try to imagine what is each one of these graphs, right? So So let's say the top graph, this one. And that graph, actually for all of them, you have the same amount of enzymes, right? And you go, and you will go through a reaction that you will add to the top graph one certain starting concentration of S2. You add that concentration of S2, and then you add S1 and you see what happens. And you build that graph. Then you start with a second. You start a different concentration, you have a different, same concentration of enzyme, same amount of enzyme, different S2, and then add S1 and see what happens. And you build that graph. And then the third one, and the fourth one, and you put them all together. So in other words, what I was trying to say is that you have the same amount of enzyme, same amount of S1, but different amounts of S2, and you try to see what changes. You know, how the graph changes.
So that's why the top one is the one that has the ternary complex, because after you've added the S2, you're